Hey, everyone. Welcome to the 330th episode of the Internet of Things podcast. This is your host, Stacey Higginbotham, and your co-host,
Kevin Toefel.
And we have a really great show for you today. We're going to be talking about the latest news from Amazon involving its support for Matter, plus a bunch of new developer-friendly things for Madam A that you're going to want to know about. We are also going to be talking about flexible plastic chips from ARM.
What?
I know. Just you wait. Plus, more chip news from Qualcomm that's betting big on specialized wearables. And we have smart lighting devices from a brand that may surprise you. We'll explain more. And we have cybersecurity tools evaluations, which sounds incredibly boring, but it's actually really important on the industrial control side to be able to measure how well someone's security software is working. So that's what this company did. And we've got a little news from Samsung to share. Plus, our guest this week is going to be Michael Martin, the CEO of RapidSOS. We're going to be talking about bringing sensor data to 911 calls. This is actually really cool and could lead to a future where, like, your Apple Watch will dial 911 for you. So, and share all the data you need. Yee. Okay, all of this and more awaits you. But first, we have to hear from one of our sponsors. This week's sponsor is Trek 10. And Trek 10 is an AWS premier consulting partner with competencies in the IoT, DevOps, and managed services. They focus 100% on AWS, and they have years of experience working with the AWS cloud. They also will support new smart products and legacy industrial systems. They ensure AWS best practices for security, scalability, and reliability. All of this is really good stuff. So, if you want to learn more about Trek 10, you can visit trek10.com/IoT. That's trek10.com/IoT. Okay, Kevin, man, we've been waiting, what, a couple months for this? But today...
Yeah, I got to get off my high horse on Amazon with not talking about Matter support because you had a... I assume you had a chat with somebody.
I did. I had a chat with two somebodies at Amazon. And this week is Amazon's... Oh, I'm going to screw it up. It's Madam A Live. So the digital assistant that Amazon has, we try not to say its name because we don't want to invoke everyone's Echo devices.
She who shall not be named.
Exactly. But this isn't a Voldemort situation. This is just a politeness situation. So Madam A, they're having a conference dedicated to Madam A this week. And as part of that, they announced their plans for supporting the Matter protocol. And if y'all don't remember... Although, how could you forget? The Matter protocol is a smart home interoperability protocol that was announced back in December 2019 by Amazon, Samsung, Google, and Apple. And the whole idea was like to get your smart devices to play together. So we've heard from Google, we've heard from Apple about their plans, and finally, we hear from Amazon. And Amazon says the most important information that you want to know is yes, most of your existing Echo devices will support Matter. This includes all current generation Echo devices and all the way back, actually, the only ones that won't get support are going to be the first gen Echo, Echo Dot, and the Echo Tap, which, Kevin, do you still have your Echo Tap?
Yeah, let's see. That's the one with the battery. So it's, yes, I do not have that one. I gifted that to somebody who could use an Echo. And I understand why that may not support Matter at this point. It's not a pluggable, plugged-in device. The first generation Echo, that doesn't surprise me either because...
That was 2014, 2015.
Yeah.
Mine still, I still have one and it still works, but apparently not getting the Matter update.
Yeah. Yeah, okay, and then the original Echo Dots as well, huh? Which were probably built on, you know, similar technology to the original Echo inside.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's fine. That's fine.
That's fine. We accept that.
No, because most people, and I could be wrong, and please let me know if I am, listeners. It wouldn't be the first time, won't be the last. I'm guessing most people don't have one Echo in their house. They may have some of these devices that are not supporting Matter in the future, but they probably have other devices that are.
True. And, all right, so this also means, so this is all only the Echo devices. We're going to hear more from other Amazon-owned brands like Ring at some other point in time. So just so y'all know, because that was my first question. I was like, wait a second, what about Ring? Mm-hmm. What about Eero? I don't know about, does Amazon own any other smart home brands?
Blink.
Oh, Blink. Oh, yeah, but cameras aren't supported.
Cameras aren't supported, so that's a kind of a non-issue at the moment.
Anyway, all right. Yeah. Sorry.
I'm like, they own enough, in my opinion.
They own a lot. So the other thing that comes with Matter support is that Amazon is going to now have local control of devices over the Echo devices. And I know we talked about this last week, and I have to issue a little bit of a correction / clarification. What we talked about last week with enabling local control only works with Echo devices with Zigbee chips in them. But after Matter support arrives, and we don't know when because nobody knows when the Matter spec is going to be formalized and officially released, but soon after that is when your Echo devices will get this support, they will also have local control.
Correct. We don't know when the spec will officially be official, but we expect it to be by the end of the year.
Yeah, they said late fall. So
2022 then. Okay.
Well, I mean, people are planning some devices for the holidays. I think you'll see more, you know, I think we'll see a lot at CES.
Exactly. Yeah. And then the other thing you said about local control, I've also been getting on Amazon for the past several months, not hearing much about local control when its competitors in this space have been talking about it. And maybe this is why they've been quiet, because they weren't going to do their own local SDKs and so on like others. They said, we'll just wait for Matter. So I'll back off. That's fair.
It's probably easier for developers. You don't have to implement one thing and then be like, now I got to change it. So that's frustrating. And speaking of frustrating.
Oh, wow.
Amazon is, as part of Matter, it's going to release a new frustration-free setup SDK. That whole setup is basically when you buy a device on Amazon that works with the Matome ecosystem. If you buy it, you can actually link it to your account. And when that device comes in, it automatically gets on your network and attaches to your Echo device. It's pretty cool.
You taught me something before the show. I didn't know that the non-Amazon branded devices are actually supported with this as well, because I haven't bought any of them from Amazon.
Yeah, I buy a lot of my smart home gear from Amazon, and you can always see, and even when you look at it, you can see like, this will work with this device. And anyway, if the developers implemented this SDK, it will work and it's great.
Right. So it saves the setup time and the input and so on. That makes sense. Are we going to talk about frustration-free setup and that acronym?
No, we're not going to talk about that acronym because this is a child-friendly podcast, my friend.
Okay. Frustration-free setup. I'll just leave it there.
FFS. Okay, man.
Just leave it there.
All right. And also with this, the cool thing is if you're supporting frustration-free setup with Matter, what that also means is you could bring, if you buy a device on Amazon and your account is set up to work that way, you could actually bring a device in, have it connect to your network, and you could control it using any other Matter compliant hub, basically a controller, any other Matter compliant hub using what they call the multi-admin feature. So that's pretty nice. So Amazon's basically, if you buy something on Amazon and they're going to support this, then you could tie it into lots of stuff very easily.
Yay. Yeah. And this is the first time that I've seen them. Well, I wouldn't say they're opening up. They're adopting something that is more open to let you use other devices and even digital assistants to control your Amazon devices or vice versa.
And there's more on that. So Amazon is also going to bring data from non-Matter devices that are controlled by Matter compliant bridges into your smart home. And basically what this means is your existing non-Matter compliant devices, like all my Z-Wave locks, for example, they're not going to get Matter support. But if I attach them to like SmartThings that is going to support Matter, then Amazon will still control it just like they do today. So this is basically, don't freak out. If you're using Matome, you're going to be able to still control your existing stuff and the new Matter stuff you bring in.
Okay. And this is big because the Amazon Echo, I forget what they call it.
Echo Plus?
The Echo Plus, exactly. Which was the first Echo device with the Zigbee chip inside. So it could act as like a Zigbee bridge, controller, hub, whatever you want to call it. That only works with Amazon Zigbee devices, if I'm not mistaken.
Certain Zigbee devices.
Right. This changes that and opens it up in a big way.
You're right. I didn't think about that. So yeah, that's great. Woo. All right. And final little bits related to Matter. Amazon's going to use Matter to standardize communication for smart TVs. So they're already working to have a consistent way to use voice to launch content on your televisions. And this is not Matter related, but there is, we've talked about it a long time ago. There's an effort called the Voice Interoperability Initiative. It's like Qualcomm, Facebook, tons of companies are members of this. And the whole goal was to basically build multiple voice assistants into one product. So the idea is you could just choose your voice assistant easily on a product. And Amazon is now announcing something called the Multi-Agent Experience Toolkit, the Max Toolkit, that's going to let developers do this. So that's pretty cool because we might see devices that can run Madam A, but would also run Google Assistant or the Facebook portal.
So this reminds me of the Sonos One, which originally came with Madam A and then later got Google Assistant support, but it couldn't do it at the same time, so to speak. You couldn't ask one digital assistant a question and then immediately ask the other digital assistant a question on the same device because you had to configure the device to use one or the other. So this is like what Sonos did, only it's a step further, and I suspect it's more of a standardized thing. But my question is, and we don't know the answer, I don't think, is this going to be available to non-Amazon devices, like such as Google speakers and Apple's?
Oh, could I put Madam A on a Google speaker?
Right.
Here's where I see Amazon going with this news. Amazon, and we'll see with some of the other stuff they're talking about here, is building out the digital assistant, not as a single personality, but as the infrastructure and probably the data graphs behind it and the links behind it. So if you think about even probably the hardware reference designs, right? So if you think about a digital assistant, at its components, it's several cloud services, some databases. We've got NLP, so natural language processing. I was like, I can't think of it right now. So you've got a lot of elements that are just straight up computing elements. And I think what Amazon's moving towards is offering that, but it doesn't need to be Madam A. They're just like, let's build this out as a service. And like, for example, it's going to open up its expertise on this to help other companies create their own custom assistants for their devices. So they're working with a car company right now, but they could work with an oven maker like Whirlpool and be like, and again, this gets to, do I really want to be saying like, hey, Whirlpool, turn on the oven?
Yeah, probably not. Probably not, unless you want to have cutesy names for every single thing in your house. And yeah, we just saw this with the FCC filing for a Verizon smart display that uses this exact technology. It's Amazon's technology with a custom wake word, hey Verizon, which I still don't get that product, but that's a whole other issue entirely. So yeah, that makes sense. I'm a little surprised Microsoft hasn't done this agnostic backend technology for voice assistants.
Here's what I think happened. I think everyone was like, holy cow, the digital assistant, it's big, it's exciting. And they focused on the actual personality / skill set. Mm-hmm. But Amazon is like, you know, you think about Amazon, when it comes to infrastructure, nobody beats Amazon. They take right. this, I mean, so I think Microsoft got fixated on Cortana as an entity, not as a packaged service.
Considering the fact that, do you know where Cortana, the name, actually comes from?
It was a video game, yeah?
It was in Halo. It was the digital avatar that helped you out in the Halo video game from 20-odd years ago. And so, yeah, that only speaks more to your point. They focused on the personality.
Right. And I think Google's probably focused less on the personality and more on the data graphs, like the actual data it has in there.
Yeah, they want to provide any and all data as quickly as possible to you in any way they can. So, yes.
And then Apple, I don't know. I'm like, what is Apple? Because like, you know, Apple, I feel, is definitely a fast follower and probably a more graceful follower in some instances. But, you know, Apple's
plus,
not.
Plus, they bought the technology.
Yeah, they did. They bought the Siri technology from, was it Siri? Was it
no,
the company called Siri?
I forget the name of it.
It starts with an S. The guys who built that actually built another company called Viv that Samsung bought that became some of it. It's actually part of Samsung's underlying technology.
Bixby, probably.
And it's not Bixby. It's actually, using voice to tell a computer what to do and having the computer figure out what programs it needs to open and do it.
Yes, like an intense system or something like that. And it was SRI, International Artificial Intelligence Center.
There we go.
Siri is a spinoff from the project developed by the SRI.
Got it. Yeah, they do some cool stuff there. Okay, that was a bit into the business models and where we think we're going here. But back to Amazon, because there's still more information.
There's more?
Gosh, you know how they get. They're like, let's launch 100 pieces of news in one
day. They were chatty with you.
Oh, this doesn't all come from them. This also comes from their press releases and their
Oh, I'm glad they sent them to you.
Yeah, aren't you? Aren't you, Kevin?
Yeah.
So more money options are available to developers on the Madam A front. So they're going to do a couple things. One, they're launching something called paid skills. As a developer, you can now create a paid skill. So customers can pay a one-time fee to get access to the content. I'm excited about that. There are some things I would totally pay for, like I would actually pay for calorie counting on my Echo or just calorie tracking. Like I ate an egg and then at the end of the day, it would be like, you've consumed 800 calories, sir. No,
that's not
enough.
Egg. Was it ostrich egg? What do you eat?
Yeah. I ate 12 eggs and one of them was an ostrich egg. Okay. And let's see, developers can also get referral fees. So if you are... A developer can build something to like allow people to add a product into their Amazon cart. And if the person buys it, they get a referral fee. They also will add referral fees to replenishment devices. So if you're a company like Ecobee or Carrier with like an air filter replacement program, you can actually get a referral fee if people buy those filters through Amazon. I know that everybody in the smart home is like, I need a revenue model. So this opens up a kind of slightly more interesting revenue model that also cuts Amazon into the deal.
I mean, it's an affiliate type of approach, and it makes sense because if people are going to buy them anyway and you can provide a service that gets them to them, I mean, that's what Amazon does with its ad business completely. So I don't see a problem with that.
Yeah, instead of doing it to, you know, bits, it's doing it with atoms. I do wonder, like, if you're Resideo and you sell your filters directly, why would you want to send them through Amazon? So that's an interesting little wrinkle there.
I thought you were going to say instead of doing it with bits, they're doing it with bytes. I got to be honest.
But there are no bytes. Unless we're talking about snacks. Were we talking about snacks, Kevin?
No. So I got my school ID card this week. I'm sorry.
Oh, congratulations. Y'all, Kevin's going to be a Georgia Tech computer science master's candidate? Master's student?
Yeah.
What do they call that?
I don't know. I'm in the
smart.
Fall cohort. I'm in the cohort.
He's smart.
My first cohort.
Yay. We're excited. He's still going to be on the show, though. So.
Oh, yeah.
Don't worry. All right. Let's see. They're adding skills for food delivery. Send a phone skill that lets you start a conversation with Madam A, and then it'll go to your mobile device. And the worst news of all is they're adding something called proactive experiences that are going to use event triggers and proactive suggestions. And what this means...
Say what now?
Yeah, I know. Let me just translate this for you. Madam A is going to get chattier. Right now, Amazon uses this for things like hunches, but now other developers can build proactive experiences into their skills. So if you use a workout skill, it might be like, psst, it's 7 a.m., you usually work out by now. Work out. I am not excited by this. They're going to start out with the Whole Foods delivery option. So we'll see how that works. But I'm a little like, I don't know how much I want Amazon talking to me. We'll see.
Less is more in my case.
Yeah. I mean, sometimes it is helpful. Like, hey, your door isn't locked and it usually is by this time of night. Do you want to lock it? And I'm like, yeah, thanks.
And that's fine, but that's not product related. That's different to me. I don't know how I want to quantify that, but it's different to me.
And some of them are like, hey, it looks like you're going for a run. Do you want to play this playlist?
Okay. No, that's helpful.
The workout one is basically, I mean, if you want to work out and Madam A just prompts you.
There's context and then there's context is what I'm saying.
Yeah. I think we're going to go through this. Remember when notifications were just uncontrollable and annoying as all get out? I think we're going to go through that.
Still are.
Yeah, but you can
Oh, yeah. No, I've shut most of them off, and I'm taking full advantage of Do Not Disturb more often than not. So, yes. Yes.
Yes. Okay. Hey, let's talk about plastic chips.
Plastic chips?
Yes. ARM has built a 32-bit microcontroller on top of a flexible plastic substrate. This is cool because, and this is just a research effort.
Yeah, because this chip is not very powerful. This is a Cortex-M1 with 128 bytes of RAM and 56 bytes of ROM.
Yes, this is not, anyway.
Yeah.
Oh, can I just tell you, they call their manufacturing on plastic, their whole effort, they call it the Plastic Armpit Project.
Are you kidding me?
No.
That's almost as bad as frustration-free setup.
FFS, y'all. Yeah. All right. But what's happening is they've got a paper out in Nature, and they're saying you can print these chips on flexible materials, which Kevin is convinced is a big thing. I
do think it has big potential. And I'm not going to say it's a big thing, but it's got big potential once they scale up the actual processing chops here, because you can get a totally different design, maybe a more efficient and cheaper design in your sensors that might need a low powered chip. If you can make the chip actually on a flexible, you know, substrate instead of a hard, rigid board, you know? So my take here is if they can scale this up to make it more usable, I mean, I'm sure certain sensors will be fine with this, but the bulk of them probably not. If they can scale this up in terms of compute power, you could see smaller, cheaper sensors and easier designs, easier to build. And, mm-hmm. There's a lot of potential here for that.
And for wearables. Think about what you
can
do with rings.
That's a good point, yes.
I mean, or clothing. There's a lot of, I mean, like we've been trying to do, I mean, think about like foldable phones. We've been trying to make computers less rigid, more flexible for decades. So this is a really good step.
Yay. Yeah, we've got to break out of the slabs and the little square and round
boxes,
bricks that are on our wrists and all. I mean, we need to do that. And we can't until technology like this comes forward.
So, yay. All right. Speaking of wearables, Qualcomm is doing a big wearable push. They launched a bunch of new platforms. These are highly specialized. I found this really interesting because they're creating a new platform. They haven't named it. It's going to go beyond the current Qualcomm Snapdragon range that's used in a lot of the Wear OS smartwatches, possibly because Google is talking about working with Tizen on the Fitbit wearables. I don't even know. We still don't know what's going to happen there with the Google acquisition of Fitbit and what will happen.
Yeah, and the
watches.
Samsung collaboration that they announced a month or two ago, yes. Honestly, Google is completely dependent on Qualcomm right now for a lot of things. All of its hardware partners it has worked with and production partners for the Pixel devices, for example, the phones are all Qualcomm-based. But more on the smartwatch side, where they're really hurting, the hardware has been lagging so bad. It doesn't matter every year at Google I.O. that Google redesigns its wearable OS platform or bought Fitbit or whatever it does, because Qualcomm's 3100 chips have just not been up to snuff. And then they announced the Qualcomm 4100 chips and the 4100 Plus, and nobody seems to want to use them because Google can't even get any market share for wearables. So they need this, whatever it's going to be named, at least on the wearable side.
And Qualcomm's going to redesign it from the ground up. This is going to follow on from the 4100 and 4100 Plus chips. And I think they're taking a smart tack because the general interest market is Apple devices for everybody on Apple. So the Apple Watch or Fitbits, if you're not on the Apple ecosystem, or if you're just kind of, my daughter would call it a casual in the fitness space. But Qualcomm's going to really focus on kids' smartwatches, wearables for seniors, and pet trackers. So we'll see. I mean, I can see how if you optimize for those devices, you're going to end up with some different features. But yeah, anyway, not a lot there. It's going to happen. Exciting, or maybe not exciting, but worth noting. Hey, Kevin, you're never going to believe what brand is entering the smart lighting market.
Actually, I will, because I cheated and looked in the show notes already.
Oh, Kevin.
Yes, it's an old tire company. I think that's how they got their start, to be honest.
Rain boots, actually.
Rain boots, that's it. Yes, galoshes, as we like to call them.
Wellies.
Yeah. We're talking about Nokia, of all companies. And to be honest, We're also talking about a company called Smart Labs, and it looks like Smart Labs is done a branding collaboration with Nokia, because the first ever Nokia smart lighting products were just announced, actually, for the United States. And I didn't even know that Nokia had any smart lighting products in the United States. Like, maybe these were the first.
They don't, but Smart Labs does. Smart Labs has been around since 1992, building smart home products.
Well, so Nokia and its galoshes have been around a lot longer than that.
True. And so now they have the Nokia brand. They've licensed the Nokia brand for their new lighting portfolio.
And what a portfolio it is.
Kevin is not as excited about these. We'll have Kevin tell you.
Let's go through the products and then I'll explain why.
Okay. So they have several light switch configurations, including a dimmer, a smart panel, a paddle switch. They have smart outlets, and they also
have
a
dial.
I mentioned the dial, didn't I?
Maybe you call it something different, but okay.
Okay.
You said dimmer. Okay. Yeah, that's fair. That's fair. I have toggle dimmers in my house. That's why I didn't make the connection. No pun intended. They also have a smart outlet. I don't know if you mentioned that.
I did. Are you not listening to me? What's happening?
And they have a paddle and they have a dial and a bridge. Oh, there's a bridge. Did you mention the bridge?
I was getting to the bridge. So here we go.
So okay. So we've obviously covered all the products twice, maybe three times.
Maybe more.
So here's the thing. As I started looking at the specs of these, I started getting very upset. And here's why. Because they use or combine radio frequency and power line for reliability and responsiveness. So basically, these are using 900 megahertz spectrum, which, in fairness, other companies do use for products. Wyze uses that, and Amazon Sidewalk devices will use 900 megahertz. So that's okay. And power line. So if you want to use power line in the bridge, which supports 1,000 connections.
That's a lot of light switches.
Yeah. You'd have to plug in an Ethernet cable to the bridge, and that irks me right off the bat. Secondly, there's a bridge, obviously, because I just mentioned it. And I don't have a problem with bridges and hubs, even though it sounds like I do. It's the outlets. I'm at a loss for usable outlets in my house, and every one of these takes one up, and it irks me. So my other issue here is, why are they doing this proprietary thing when they could have just gotten on board with Matter and Thread and all that? Why?
They could get on board with Matter. Matter supports Ethernet. I would say, I'm going to throw this out here, because there are a lot of older, maybe more experienced people in the smart home space who really love power over Ethernet. They're going to love these products. The only other thing that's worth mentioning about these products, they support dimming of fluorescent lights.
That's a good point.
This would be a way to smarten your fluorescent lights. And I had fluorescent lights in my old house, and I had to go with like a very special Lutron dimmer. I can't remember the product SKU, but it was very hard to find something, and it would only turn it on and off. It didn't dim. And there are plenty of people who have homes built in the 80s that are going to have those kitchens with those big old fluorescent lights on the top.
That's a fair point. I guess I was looking at it from the market as a whole. Considering what's coming down the pike and what's available now, I just originally felt this is just not a product that will appeal to everyone.
And that's okay.
Yeah, and that is okay. I mean, there's always room for more products. I get it. But I just originally was like taken aback by this. I'm like, if you're getting in the smart home market now, is this really the direction you want to go? And okay, that's fine.
And they can always add it later.
They're not cheap either.
Oh, they're $39 to $59.99.
The bridge is $39, but most of the switches are $59.99.
That's par. I mean, I paid...
Well, you're Lutron. You're in the upper high end product
fancy,
lines.
Fancy, but you know what?
Fancy,
they
girl.
Work. Okay, let's talk about industrial IoT security. Oh, what? Where are we going? I know it's whiplashing. And I'm going to do a bad job saying this company's name because I don't know how to say it.
Because it's hard.
Well, because I suspect it's an acronym, and I just don't know. It's Mitre? Mitre? Ingenuity, MITRE. Feel free, someone call me, tell me, or send me a pronunciation guide. They evaluated several industrial IoT security products and how well they performed against the Triton malware, and basically have created an online portal where you can compare five different products together. So those products are products from Microsoft, Armis, Clarity, Dragos, and the Institute for Information Industry. And there's tons of information here. I'm just going to put it in the show notes, but it's actually pretty cool. And we talk a lot about industrial IoT security breaches, and Mitra has created the Attack Evaluations Program and are trying to create a way to evaluate all those things in a neutral manner. So worth looking at if you're concerned about this. And based on the response to many of the interviews I've done, I've had people from most of these companies on the show, and y'all have enjoyed them. So that's it on the IoT security front. Here's a little news brief about an upcoming event.
Yes, and we kind of touched upon this topic briefly a few minutes ago. Samsung has announced their Samsung Unpacked event, which you will be able to tune in. And that's kind of why I just wanted to throw this out there real quick. August 11th, if you're interested in, of course, they'll have the latest Samsung foldable phones and so on. But what I'm calling the Wear Zen Bit wearable, calling it that because this is probably going to be the first Google Wear plus Fitbit plus Tizen device coming from Samsung. So that will be interesting to hear from a data integration standpoint, sensors, and maybe even, well, I was going to say the new Qualcomm chip maybe, but it wouldn't surprise me if a Samsung Exynos chip is in this, but we'll have to see. So anyway, you can tune in along with me and everybody else and geek out on August 11th.
Yay! And that concludes the news portion of this week's show. Now it is time for the Internet of Things podcast hotline, the part of the show where you participate. You can call us and ask us your questions, and when you do, you'll be entered to win this month's prize, which is an IoT device grab bag. Random stuff. I've got a Arlo doorbell in there. I've got a Wyze outlet. I don't know what else is in there.
Old Echo devices that won't support Matter.
That's true. My original Echo? No. We'll find some good stuff for you. Maybe some light bulbs. I don't know. Okay. If you would like to be entered to win, all you have to do is call us at 512-623-7424. And I might remind you that the IoT Podcast Hotline is sponsored by Very, which is a fully distributed IoT engineering firm that will help you get your biggest projects fully operational on time and on budget. If you want to discover what Very can do for you, go to verypossible.com. Okay, and this week's question comes from Dean. I feel like, Dean, we talk to you a lot. Hello, Dean. Let's hear what you have to say.
Stacey and Kevin, love your show. This is Dean from the Twin Cities. My question is, yes, it goes with last week's update. My wife and I, we are waist deep into the Wyze, wondrous world of stuff. And at the face, it meets our needs. One thing I haven't found a workaround for is Hue lights coming on at sunset and then, you know, static closing them down at a other time. Is there a workaround for Wyze lights or Wyze outlets to be set to come on at sunset or sunrise or one of those markers that changes through the year, and it's just nice to have as the house is getting dark? That's all. Have a great one, and keep up the great work.
Oh, another Wyze question. You guys love these devices.
Well, they have more products than anybody else, so
and they're
that's
cheap.
Why we get more questions, and they're cheap.
They're not terrible.
No. But I had looked into this a while back, so I thought I knew the answer, but we double-checked. And in the Wyze app, you can create rules to turn lights on or off at certain times, but they're static times. They will not change, such as a sunrise or sunset. You don't have that option. And that's unfortunate. But if you want to, you can connect IFT with your Wyze account, and there are recipes that are pre-made for you to turn lights on at sunset, or you can create your own, you know, to turn them off at sunrise. Maybe you have that. The recipe works with weather underground data, so you will need to provide probably your zip code at the very least, so it knows when sunrise and sunset is where you live. And then each day, IFT will shoot that little command over to your Wyze lights if you've set it up, and you're good to go.
And just a reminder, IFT actually now has a paid service and a free service. You can only create 3 applets/recipes with the free service. And latency issues will be a little higher on those.
True. Very, very true. Luckily, sunrise and sunset, and you got one more that you can do for whatever for free. And latency wouldn't be an issue in this particular application because if your lights don't go on or off until 5 minutes before or after they should, then I don't think that's going to be an issue when you're talking about sunrise and sunset.
We will also tell you that your Y stuff works with Madam A. And Madam A actually has a routine where you can turn things off at sunrise and sunset.
There you go. So you got options there.
Yeah. And I don't know if you have, Dean, a Amazon Echo device in your home, but that's an option. And if you're on Google, at the end of last year, Google announced a support for sunrise, sunset routines as well. So there are three ways to do it. It's a little complicated. You can also do this in SmartThings. It's not as easy as going into the Wyze app, but it is a way to make this work. And right now, we don't know where, we know Wyze is part of the Matter consortium, but we don't know what products of theirs will support it. So we don't know how else that might be brought to bear. But for now, those are three options that will work for you.
And if it were me, I would go with the second or third option first, not because of the paid subscription bit to IFT, but from a latency standpoint, it's probably going to, the rule you set up will probably occur more close to the correct time. Again, latency is not an issue, but why not have it if you can get it, you know?
Why not find out exactly when sunrise, sunsets
happens? Why not? Why not?
All right. Well, Dean, hopefully we have answered your question. And if anyone else had that question, now you know. And remember, if you would like to have your question answered on the show, give us a call. Ask us a question at 512-623-7424. And now it is time to go to our guest, Michael Martin, the CEO of Rapid SOS, who's going to be talking to us about turning your IoT devices into sensors for the use of first responders. But before we go to him, let's hear from our sponsor. This week's sponsor is Silicon Labs, and it's Works With. Hey, everyone. We are taking a quick break from the Internet of Things podcast for a message from our sponsor. This week's sponsor is Silicon Labs. And I'd love to welcome Jake Alamat, who is vice president and general manager of the Home and Life business unit at Silicon Labs. Today, Jake is going to talk to us about Works With, which is Silicon Labs' virtual conference coming up in mid-September. And for those who don't know Silicon Labs, can you tell us a little bit about the company?
Silicon Labs is the leader of intelligent wireless connectivity, and we are 100% focused on IoT. Our products are at the center of every wireless protocol, IoT ecosystem, and standards body, helping to make the IoT a more intuitive, interoperable, and secure place.
And this is going to be the second year Silicon Labs is hosting Works With. What is Works With, and why is this event so unique?
Works With is the only event in the world that brings together all of the developers in IoT in one place where they can immerse themselves in unbiased expert discussions and experience hands-on training and workshops led by experts. We're uniquely positioned to host an event like Works With because we're one of the only companies in the world that drives all the key wireless connectivity protocols and standards to make IoT possible. We're once again this year bringing together all the big names and ecosystems in the industry to provide the world's only forum where IoT decision makers and device developers can receive practical training and actionable insights to build and deploy and interconnect all the latest smart homes, smart cities, and industrial IoT technologies to get them to market faster.
So I understand this event is going to have four distinct IoT tracks. Can you give us a preview of what to expect from the smart home track?
We deliver solutions for all segments of IoT, and we want Works With to reflect not only the smart home ecosystems, but smart cities, industrial IoT, and more. That said, there's an incredible amount of activity happening in the smart home, and Works With is the best and only place to get a full understanding of where the smart home is, how to effectively develop for it, and where it's going. The topics are going to include items like Apple's HomeKit and its development over OpenThread, the new Matter standard, Amazon Sidewalk, security best practices, RF range extensions, and the list goes on and on. These technical sessions that we're providing, they're all designed by expert engineers with the goal of helping device makers accelerate product development and time to market. No other conference exists that delivers this deep level of technical training with wireless experts.
So who should attend Works With and why?
WorkSwift is great for everyone in the IoT industry, but it's really ideal for software developers, hardware engineers, product managers, and business leaders. WorkSwift is a great way to stay on top of what's happening in the IoT, develop and deliver IoT solutions faster, and strengthen partnerships. This year, just like last year, registration is free. Get online and join us for September 14th and 15th when we're going to have the event. Register today at workswith.scilabs.com.
Hey everyone, welcome back to the Internet of Things podcast. This is your host, Stacey Higginbotham, and today's guest is Michael Martin, who is CEO of RapidSOS. And we are going to be talking today about turning your IoT devices into sensors for emergency responders, basically. So hello, Michael, how are you today?
I'm good, Stacey. Thanks for having me on. Great to connect here.
I am really excited. We are having you on because you guys just did a deal with SimpliSafe, and it feels like it might be one of your first forays into what I think of as the smart home. Is that fair?
Yeah, so we power about 350 million connected devices today. Our two biggest sources of those are our work with Apple and Google. And our first home security partner was a company called Cove Smart Security. But SimpliSafe is significantly expanding kind of the reach of that platform into the connected home. So really excited about this one. And I think more than anything, excited about the impact that I think we're going to be able to have together.
We're going to get to the impact. But first, let's tell people exactly what you do.
RapidSOS is an emergency response data platform. So what we do basically is link any connected device directly into 911 and first responder systems across the United States. So we spent roughly the last 8 years and $200 million building those connections into every major 911 system, those software systems you'd see running in ambulances and fire trucks and all that. And so the result for a consumer is when you call 911 today, if you're on a smartphone, for example, with our work with Apple and Google, that means the 911 now is going to receive your precise location updated continuously. And depending on your settings, you might also have opted into sharing other sorts of life-saving data. And we've recently expanded that work for all sorts of other connected devices, from your connected home, your connected car, wearable and digital health devices. This ecosystem of devices is now able to work together to save your life when you need it most.
Okay, so let's take this out a few years before we get to all the practical stuff that's going to be like, what could this mean? Let's say that I am in my home, which has many smart devices, and I have a heart attack, and I've got a Fitbit. What kind of information is going to go, and does someone actually have to call? Where are we headed with this?
Yeah, and I almost think to know where we're headed, it's probably worth spending maybe a minute on where we are today, just for the context. So I think many of us, 911 is a service that we all rely on and count on, but we don't really know a lot about. And so the U.S. 911 system actually dates to the 1960s and was really built, every city in America basically built their own system in the 1960s and 1970s. And so today you have about 6,000 different 911 agencies across the United States alone, and they're running on approximately 25,000 different software systems. So it is this incredibly complicated system that was built in the 1960s and remains largely analog-based today. So today in an emergency, if you call 911 typically, Stacey, like they wouldn't even know your name, much less details like your medical information, like you just described for that use case, right? And so what we've built now is this rich data of connection integrated across those flows. And what that enables is any connected device to work collectively with your 911 and first responder systems to actually save your life in an emergency. So fast forward to that heart attack, which is most folks aware, this is the leading cause of death in the United States, actually out of hospital cardiac arrest, over 350,000 fatalities a year. If you are wearing a wearable device now, it can actually not only share your exact location and nature of that emergency, but even stream real-time data into the ambulance. So for example, your pulse rate, your pulse ox levels, you know, various other indicators that can really help drive the most effective response possible.
Okay, so now we get to the how the heck do they do this? There's a lot of pieces here that need to come together. There's the people in the ambulance or the software the ambulance is using. There is the 911 dispatch. They've got their own software. And as you said, it's super fragmented. And then my devices have to have some sort of tie-in to your system, it sounds like. And then I, as a user, also have to understand that I want to share that data. Maybe I don't. So how does all that come together, and how far are you into creating that ecosystem?
There's fundamentally three pieces to make all this work. So the first is the interconnection into the device itself. So RapidSOS today powers a little over 350 million devices. Our largest partners are Apple and Google, but we work with Uber, various connected home platforms. As we just mentioned, we now work with SimpliSafe and Cove Smart Security, various connected buildings, et cetera. Then we add in a verification step, so 24/7 professional monitoring. So that may or may not be needed. It depends on the use case. But in many cases, we still aren't yet at the sophistication at the sensor level where we are ready to initiate a direct 911 connection without some sort of human verification. So next, we're going to verify that incident is real. And then third is we're going to have all that information, once it's verified, directly onto the screen of 911 and first responder systems. And that's really the complexity here that took 8 years, is really partnering with 911 to understand how do we do that. That requires integrating not only into those software systems, but also actually into the operational flows that those first responders are using every day.
And that gets to another point is, golly, do they even want this? I mean, I look at something like in the smart home, for example, like if my house is on fire, I imagine firefighters would be really interested in knowing if there are any people left in the building, right? And where they might be. And so I might have devices that could indicate that. But like if I think about a paramedic, do they really want access to all of this data, or would it be overwhelming?
Yeah. I mean, it is a great point, Stacey. When I started this, I was... So I grew up in a rural farming community in Indiana and came to New York City to work in venture capital. And I just had my welcome to New York City mugging experience, I think, for lack of a better phrase. And it's the first time I ever thought about calling 911. And it was the first time I realized that, like, in the middle of whatever your emergency is, a heart attack, assault, kidnapping, right? Like, if you can't somehow get out your phone, dial a number, and have this coherent conversation, like, there's almost no ability to send help. So certain information is absolutely vital on every single incident, obviously the location. But then you start, as we kind of move and expand into all the types of data that's around us, you're exactly right. This is all about the right data, the right place at the right time. And that's something that took a lot of time for us to figure out how to do well. I'll never forget, Stacey, like it was the very first 911 call that I ever listened in on. I was in rural Massachusetts when this mother called. Her son had committed suicide. And I mean, you can imagine she was just hysterical, screaming for help. He hung himself in the closet. And I actually took off my headset. I walked outside, you know, and I had to kind of calm down a bit. The 911 communicator didn't have that luxury. Like, she had to stay on the phone with that mother for the next 9 minutes, figure out her address, and stayed with her until 911 arrived, right? So, like, a live video stream from a Nest camera of a lifeless child, you know, would not have been helpful there. On the flip side, right, like, 20% of U.S. 911 traffic today approximately comes from alarm incidents, and over 90% of those incidents are false. So knowing that multiple sensors are going off indicating that there is smoke, you know, in the home can totally transform how the fire department thinks about response versus, you know, burning the toast in the toaster again. This is what took so much time, was figuring out the right data, the right place at the right time that can actually drive the fastest, most effective response possible. And that's been a long journey of iteration that we're continuing to work on.
Got it. Okay. And that also changes things from a policy and maybe even a liability perspective, because I think about, like, if you have limited resources and you're getting more data, you could probably triage more effectively. Because I know there are plenty of places in the U.S. today that, you know, 911 is overwhelmed. You can't actually reach people. And I don't know if there is talk about helping with something like that or not, or if this is really even an option here.
Yeah, I think it is worth pausing on the last point. I mean, 911 telecommunicators do extraordinary work. They're managing 650,000 emergencies a day in the United States, right? And they've been doing that often, like not even knowing your name. So the ability to now provide precise location, to have all the rich information to immediately say, hey, based off the data, these are the types of units that we need to dispatch, and not to have a 5-minute back and forth conversation with that caller, right? Not to have to send one police car when you really needed a whole fire brigade. Like, that is transformative about how we think about utilizing these precious resources in response. That's something we've been working a lot with 911 and first responders. I'll just give you a recent example. The other day, we had a connected car incident where a mother was driving. She had 3 kids in the vehicle. She skidded off the road and was down in a ravine. And basically, she would not, you know, she managed to call 911, but had no idea basically where she was, right? Previously, you would have dispatched one police car, and they would have driven that road to try to look for something, right? But we were able to pass the exact location and really critical information from the vehicle that informed 911 that, hey, this was a more severe incident. So we were able to dispatch ambulances immediately and send them directly to the location of that vehicle. So that's an example, just one example of how data can totally transform the emergency response process.
With that in mind, what sensors would be most useful in the home? I guess in the car, it's probably location, but what kind of devices do you want to see online for this to work better?
Yeah, I mean, I would say generally, like, about all sorts of data can be relevant. It depends on the type of emergency. So when we started RAPSOS when we were in grad school, so we actually built an emergency data model where we studied 12 million 911 calls, and we looked at every single question the 911 operator would ask. So we've taken a fairly analytical approach to that. So obviously every call requires location data. But for example, knowing the age of the 911 caller, that's relevant for about 7.1% of US 911 traffic, or it's about 17.7 million calls a year. You need to know the age. So location is going to be critically important, but generally all types of IoT data we're able to kind of input into the existing emergency protocols and slot in the right information at the right time. The other one that I'll specifically call out, though, is multimedia. I think we are on the cusp of a real revolution in emergency response around the use of video and multimedia clips, particularly with the growing sophistication of AI, where you don't have to watch a whole clip. You can specifically see the clip where someone breaks into a home, right? And you can verify very quickly that that's real. In a commercial security application, you get a feel for how many resources you need. You know, are the perpetrators armed? That sort of information can be critically important for first responders.
And how do they communicate with the consumer what this data might be used for? So if I'm thinking about something like Ring, for example, there's a huge and legitimate, I would say, privacy concern around sharing their data with police, sharing camera data with police, for example. And I also, you know, I don't necessarily tell all of my devices the truth about me because I'm like, they don't need to know. So how do you communicate that to users?
Yeah. So, you know, I think I'll kind of handle both issues separately. The first one on privacy, I think privacy is critically important here, right? So location is shared automatically. All other data types the user needs to opt into to share. Now, this is information that is only shared in a live 911 call and is only used to drive that response. So RAPSOS is an example. We aren't a data company. We discard all of our data. But first responders, you know, that can be really make the difference between life and death for them. So I think that from a consumer standpoint, choosing what to share, like I think for all the different times and places where we share data, like this is one of those use cases where I think it is most impactful. Is it's not about, you know, getting alcohol delivered more efficiently or getting ads targeted more. It's about, you know, the one moment in your life when you need help. 911 now knows that you have these pre-existing health conditions, right? Or they know that, hey, your daughter is still trapped inside while your home's on fire. So I think that information is literally life-saving.
So how do you communicate that to consumers? Do they download RAPSOS and then you ask them that? Or is it just part of their device setup and there's going to be a screen that comes up when I'm setting up my Nest Cam? Do you want to share these videos with emergency responders or how does that work?
Yeah, so I'll give you an example with Apple. So Apple users can now opt in to sharing their medical ID information with 911 in an emergency. And so the way that works is your location is shared automatically if you call 911 from an iPhone, but all the other data you have to manually opt in to sharing in the settings, basically. So there's a settings in the in the emergency SOS functionality or in the health app. There's a couple different places where you can toggle that on. And then on the 911 telecommunicator side, if you've activated that service, first of all, we're going to be training those 911 operators are trained by us on how to think about that data, how to use it most effectively. But secondly, there's actually a pop-up window that specifies this is from an Apple device. Please verify, only use if appropriate. So there is a fair amount of work that's gone into thinking about how do we enroll a user and give them the opportunity to share this? And then how do we actually operationalize it at the 911 center?
And then how do we get to a place where we don't have to call 911? I assume it's not the goal in every situation, but there are plenty of situations where, you know, my sensors might detect a heart attack happening before it happens almost, right? Or just as it's starting. We're getting to a point where we could have something like that. And I know there are concerns about false positives and that sort of thing. How do you think we should manage that in the future?
Yeah, I firmly believe that in the future, devices will detect emergencies before humans can, and they will understand the emergency better than humans can. So if you think about kind of a modern connected building, like the building I'm standing in right now, right? Like there is multiple smoke alarm and detectors spread out throughout the building. There is camera systems in the hallways. I'm at a hotel right now. So all this information has the ability to come together in a smart platform to immediately detect and verify emergencies versus going through the traditional flow where you would wait for a human to hear a smoke alarm and then call 911 and try to guess how severe it is or, you know, where the location is and that sort of thing. So we are already on the cusp of this, actually, with this for work with COVID and SimpliSafe now. Homes that detect these emergencies, again, it's going to a human operator to verify that information, but then that human doesn't actually have to call 911. We're actually pushing that data directly onto the screen of the 911 telecommunicator. And we're actually seeing, in many cases, several minutes faster response time just from that efficiency gain you get, let alone, you know, I think the advances we'll see is the sensors, we start to rely more and more on the sensors to actually detect and understand the incident further. So it's very early there, Stacey, but I see in the next 2 to 5 years, I think we are really going to see this proliferation of sensors that can now detect emergencies and drive that immediate response. The other field where you see this robustly, I would say, is in the connected car space, where our partnership with SiriusXM, we're similarly able to detect those emergencies very quickly and drive a much faster, more effective response using the data from the vehicle.
Sure. It's like a modern OnStar system. Okay. Well, I think that's all we have time for today. I look forward to this exciting future. I feel like we might need some guardrails in place to make sure this data is used appropriately, but I also worry that we'll be overwhelming first responders until we figure out new processes to help with this data. I think we'll probably have to go there. But thank you so much for coming on the show today to talk to us about this, Michael.
Yeah, great being here, Stacey. Thank you for the time.
And that concludes this week's episode of the Internet of Things podcast. Please join us next Thursday, and don't forget to subscribe. And if you can't get enough IoT news, I would love for you to sign up at www.stacyonIoT.com for our weekly IoT newsletter, where we explain all kinds of things that we don't even get to on the show. Once again, thank you for listening, and please subscribe.